what's right in front of you. Have you ever misplaced something?
Okay, I can imagine. Like right now. Dear friend, where are your keys?
I don't know. Have you ever misplaced something only to find out later that it was right where you left it? Have you ever frantically looked for a pair of glasses? More like the way you thought it would come. Well, it's clear from your response, and I already believe it to be so, that we all have. I think we've all missed something that was right in front of us. In our passage for today in Luke 24, we hear first about the women that we often hear about in the story of Jesus' crucifixion and his resurrection. The women who went to the tomb early on Sunday morning with spices that they had prepared to tend to Jesus' body, but who got to the tomb and the tomb was empty. And those were the same women who were the first to go back and attempt to share the good news that Jesus Christ was risen. These women believed to be Mary, the mother of James, Mary, the mother of Jesus, Mary, the wife of Cleopas, Mary Magdalene, Joanna, and others. When you look between Luke 24 and John 19, you see a fuller list of the women. They were the first to discover that the stone had been rolled away from the entrance of the tomb where Jesus had been laid, and that all that was left there were the garments he wore, his death clothing, which he had exchanged for a new set of clothes. Now, interestingly enough, the women were the first to report that the resurrection had occurred, just like Jesus said it would. But the scripture tells us there in verse 11 that the men, oh, you knew I was going there, the men didn't believe them. In fact, they thought it was nonsense. They thought the women were speaking nonsense, or my favorite one, I think it's King James or New King James, it was just an idle tale. You know, they just talk and they just talk, talk, talk. So although the women were astounded by this news that Jesus had risen, those who hadn't seen it for themselves didn't believe it. The disciples, including Thomas. And they were all skeptical of what the women said. It reminds me of the story in Acts 12 where Rhoda and the people were in the house praying for Peter, because Peter had been put in jail. And they prayed and they prayed and they prayed, probably prayed all night long for his release. And then God answered their prayer and Peter experienced a miraculous release from prison. And when he went to the house where the people were praying for him, Rhoda goes to the door to answer his call at the gate and she recognizes his voice. But in her amazement and her excitement that Peter could be outside, she didn't open the gate to let Peter in. She ran back to tell everybody else and to celebrate. Peter's here. We've been praying and he's here. And they stood there doubting what she said, debating whether or not it was really Peter or an angel. Nobody went to the gate to see who it actually was, open it up and see. They just debated it. It was right in front of them, but they missed it. But the scripture says Peter kept on knocking. Kind of like what God does with many of us. He kept on knocking. And when they finally opened the gate and saw that it was Peter, they were again astonished. They were amazed. They were greatly surprised. It's so interesting how we as praying folks are so surprised when God answers our prayer. Think about that. The way the disciples refused to believe, this is another way that this reminds me of, refused to believe that Jesus was risen when the women told them, reminds me even of the story that we talked a little bit about last week. Jesus rode into Jerusalem the week just before the Passover in what we refer to as the triumphal entry into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday. Remember, many of the people cheered for their Messiah when he came in. Remember the palm branches, Hosanna, Hosanna. But we always have to remember that some didn't cheer. There were many who doubted that he was who he said he was, and that he could do what he said he could do. And sadly, even many of those who were cheering on Palm Sunday were the same ones who cried, "Crucify him," by the end of the week. Even they had a hard time seeing Jesus, who was right in front of them. These two disciples on the road to Emmaus, Cleopas and an unnamed disciple they never named who he is, they were on their way in a direction away from Jerusalem when they encountered a stranger who we now know was Jesus. Now, just as a sidebar to show just how easy it is for us to miss clues that God sends us when we seem to have a mind of our own, it is significant to note that one of the women that went to the tomb and that saw that Jesus was gone and that Jesus and believed that Jesus was resurrected was the wife of one of these disciples. But he didn't believe her either. And so chances are, when these disciples were on the road to Emmaus going away from Jerusalem, she was with them as well because she was his wife. So she had to go along with something that she possibly didn't even agree with. But if we look at the text further, Cleopas and the other disciple were students and followers of Jesus Christ. That's what a disciple is. A disciple is a learner, somebody who is in training. These two disciples had no doubt had at least one opportunity, at least one, not more, to walk and talk with Jesus. They had most probably witnessed a number of miracles, but even also saw some of the stress and the strain by seeing Jesus' ministry up close. Now, they weren't a part of the original set of 12 disciples, but they were either numbered with the 70 that we hear Luke talk about in Luke 10, or they were numbered among the 120 that comes up later in the book of Acts, or maybe even the 500 witnesses, or some refer to them as disciples that come that Paul talks about in 1 Corinthians. But these two disciples were ones who would have known about Old Testament prophecy that predicted Jesus' coming, his crucifixion, his resurrection, and they not only would have known about the prophecy, but they probably even heard him say it. That, like the angel said there in verse 7, the Son of Man must be delivered over to the hands of sinners, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again. They no doubt knew that Jesus said that. Cleopas and the other disciple were on their way out of the town of Jerusalem on Easter morning, heading to a place called Emmaus. It's believed, that's why it's a question mark there. It's believed to be 7.5, 7 miles or so west, opposite direction from Jerusalem. And it is also possible, well, I said that earlier, so I won't say that again. These disciples weren't heading to the room where the other disciples were locked away hiding for fear that the Roman soldiers would come to get them since Jesus' body was gone and they were saying that the disciples stole it. Nor were these disciples on their way toward the borrowed tomb that Jesus was laid in after he was crucified to see for themselves if he had risen. Nor did they claw their way back to Golgotha's hill, the place of the skull, the site of the crucifixion of their Lord, to retrace his steps. Nor were they even headed to the Garden of Gethsemane, where even Jesus had prayed to God, "Let this cup pass from me, but not my will, but thy will be done." No, they were headed out of town, out the door, as they say. They were already defeated on Easter morning. I guess they didn't feel that they needed to get any further proof. They didn't believe anymore that Jesus had been resurrected, and so they gave up. Without checking out or verifying any evidence or investigating the matter, they were leaving the scene of the crime, not waiting for their Messiah.
They got up early on what we now call Easter morning, resurrection morning, and they headed west, disillusioned and distraught, giving up on the promise and marching away in mourning to a place called Emmaus, which spiritually means a place of earnest longing. Longing for something that you do not have. But what was really wrong with that, if indeed anything was wrong? Because we all know how hard it is to lose someone that you love and someone you have faith in and someone that you thought you had with you all the days of your life, or at least many more. When I was thinking about this, I thought about when my mother died in 2004. I thought I'd have her all of my life. I love my mother. I look like my mother. I act like my mother. I thought she'd be with me forever. And it was painful to even consider life without my mother. So couldn't these guys just been distraught because the one they believed in had died, even though they really should have already known that he said he was going to die, but that he would be raised? Just by way of review for a moment, we just studied faith. We learned from Hebrews 11 that faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. We learn that faith is the key that unlocks the door to our destiny, our desired end, our place of victory. And we know that without faith, it is impossible to please God. For God has already determined that his children must have faith in God in order for them to be connected to God and to receive all God has for them. And we also learn that faith without works, faith without inquiry, faith without effort, faith without searching, faith without believing, faith without trusting, faith without obedience, and faith without action is dead. The disciples were walking with this strange man who approached them on the road to their place of longing, and this man turned out to be Jesus, exactly who they wanted and needed to see, but they could not see him, even though he was standing right in front of them. And to them, he seemed clueless because he dared to ask them, "What happened? What's wrong with y'all?" They must have looked mad. "What's wrong with y'all? What happened?" And they said, the scripture says they said, and I'm just thinking it was probably an embarrassing, annoyed voice, like the tone we get when somebody seems clueless about what we're going through. "You mean you don't know about Jesus of Nazareth? He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people." And they told Jesus, they told this man that the chief priests and the rulers had handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. They crucified him. "You didn't know that? Everybody knew that." And then there is the clincher here that tells us exactly where these disciples were at the time they encountered Jesus on the road to Emmaus. The next thing they said is, "But we had hoped." But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. They didn't say he was crucified and he was the one who is to redeem Israel. Or God promised that Jesus would be our Messiah and that he would save all of Israel. And now he's gone and our hearts are broken. They didn't say that. They now said he was a prophet. You know, just like Isaiah and Jeremiah and Ezekiel, the major prophets, or even like Jonah or Micah or Amos, or even Zephaniah, the minor prophet. He was a prophet. Jesus is not being referred to anymore as the Messiah, as the anointed one, the Messiah sent by God, the Savior. He is now referred to as merely a prophet. For sure, but maybe not. Important, but maybe not that important. They said that they had hope, past tense, scratch that. They really were saying, "We thought he on their lack of belief, their lack of trust. And that's why they were going in the opposite direction. Walking away from God instead of directly into the arms of God. They lost their hope because they lost faith in the one that they said they had faith in. So why didn't they recognize the resurrected Savior? The one that was standing right in front of them. Why didn't they recognize him? The one they had followed and believed in, was his appearance different? Was he in a more glorified form? We know he wasn't because he had not been glorified yet. Or were their eyes so clouded that they could barely see the light of day? Had they turned their gaze and their focus and their belief and their trust and obedience and their actions, their faith away from the resurrected Lord? And were they now leaning unto their own understanding based on what they could see with their natural eyes and not seeing through spiritual eyes? That picture that they could see that told them that this whole thing about Jesus was just a lie and a hoax. That they thought they knew. Jesus, the one they longed for, the one they followed, was standing right in front of them, and they couldn't even see him. How many know that you can have 20/20 perfect vision, but be blinded to the spiritual things that are right in front of you? Scripture says he walked with them for a while, and Jesus ministered to them because Jesus knew the condition of their hearts. Jesus knew what they were running away from and what was holding them in bondage. Jesus knew that they needed to be reminded of what they already knew. Like with doubting Thomas, remember that story? Jesus showed up to meet these two disciples. My former pastor, he's gone on to be with the Lord now. Pastor Jones used to say, Jesus had to stop dying long enough to go and check on all these disciples on their way out of town so they could speak, so he could speak to their need and help to restore them to their rightful position in God. That's the kind of God we serve. It says he opened up the scriptures to them, and he talked about Moses and the prophets, people they knew about, people they had studied and heard about, the people who probably had inspired them for most, if not all, of their lives before Jesus died. But then their circumstances changed. Jesus even went deeper, though. He began to explain to them all of the scriptures that related to him, to Jesus, from Genesis to the Revelation, I suppose. And they saw Jesus woven all throughout God's word. Can you imagine Jesus explaining to you about Jesus, huh? Using the scriptures that you knew and telling you exactly who he is. Oh, and after convincing this man to stay with them longer, it says Jesus took the bread and he gave thanks and he broke it into pieces by three. And he began to give it to them one by one. And the Bible says their eyes were then open and they recognized him. And then he disappeared from their sight. Suddenly he was gone. He was there and then he was gone. And it hit them. Hold up, hold up, hold up. Wait a minute, whoa, whoa. Was that him? You know how you look at that prayer, prayer. Whoa, was that Jesus? In the flesh, was that him? James is like, didn't our hearts burn when he opened up the scripture? Had your heart ever burned when you hear God's word? Didn't we know there was something different when he talked about his word? Because he talked from personal experience. Didn't our hearts burn when he opened up the scriptures to us? Wasn't there something special about the way he looked inside our hearts and spoke directly to our needs? He didn't even know purpose of blessing us. He allowed us to share our hearts and our minds and our pain with him. And he listened. He really listened to us. Like one who could relate to our pain, but who knew that there was so much more to serving God than just the pain and the suffering that we have to bear. Didn't our hearts burn when the one who is the Word, the living Word, spoke the Word directly into our spirits, such that our spirit connected with His, the Holy Spirit of God? Now they could see what was standing right in front of them then. Their eyes had been opened to the things they already knew, right in the midst of their pain, right in the middle of their disappointment and despair, right at the center of their giving up and throwing in the towel. He was there all the time. I believe they couldn't see him because they did take their gaze. They took their focus off of him. And they were looking at themselves and looking at each other, looking for solutions and answers to questions and problems that only God has the answers to. Or like the angel in the shine, the angels in the shiny suits at the entrance to the empty tomb told the women, why are you looking for the living among the dead? Why are you talking to her and him? They all know nothing about the living.
Direction on our road to Emmaus, looking for love in all the
these learners, we've given up hope in the one who promised us eternal life. After the disciples realized the mistake they made and how they had brought gloom and doom on their own lives, they got up. At once they returned to Jerusalem, the place where they should have been in the first place. Once again, they were going and doing and being what God had called them to be, to do, and to where to go. Julian of Warwick, in England, she's a 14th century mystic, English mystic and theologian. She's a woman who devoted her entire life exclusively to God in the Anglican tradition. She once said this, "I look at God and I look at you and I keep looking at God." Amen. Brothers and sisters, look at God. Look to God. Watch God move. Wait on the Lord. Trust God. Put your faith in God, not in your circumstances. And watch God bring you through. Watch God bring you out. Watch God make a way out of no way. Keep your focus on God. And it is true. The Bible tells us that we are to help each other and to assist each other and to care for the needs of others. And I'm not saying you don't look, you don't try and help anybody else. You just, it's just you and God. That's not what I'm saying. But what I am saying is we must set our gaze on God so that we can hear from God and know how to serve our brother and our sister. And we don't have to worry about the arrow that flies by day or the terror that flies by night. Because God has promised to make our enemies our footstool. We can watch God prepare a table before us in the presence of our enemies. We can be assured that God will take what the enemy meant for evil and turn it around for our good. Word of the Lord. I wish I had written it, but I didn't. It's the word. What a mighty God we serve. Remember these words from the late great poet Maya Angelou. We are only as blind as we want to be. Brothers and sisters, Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. Now that we know these things, we will do well if we do them. In Jesus' name. Yeah.